Greetings, my name is Monty Martin.
And I'm Kelly McLaughlin.
And we are the Dungeon Dudes. Welcome to our channel where we cover everything D&D, including advice for players and guides for Dungeon Masters.
We upload new videos on Tuesdays and Thursdays, so please subscribe to our channel so that you never miss an episode.
Today we are looking at the darkest, bleeding edge of character builds in Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition, the Warlock Paladin Multiclass, or as we like to affectionately call it, the Witch Knight.
For all of you fans of dark and brooding characters, the macabre lost souls of dark and brooding pasts, the Witch Knight might be the right character for you. Or if you're just into the idea of a really powerful and potent multi-class build, we take our favorite elements of what we love about paladins and what we love about warlocks, with a little bit of interesting flavor and lore to go along with it that can really bring this character to life at the table.
What makes the Paladin Warlock multi-class build very unique is that you get to play a very, very strong melee damage dealer who also has some excellent spell casting, which they use primarily to augment their melee combat capabilities. You also end up with a character who is surprisingly resilient, and their focus on charisma as their main ability score means that you can play a bit of the party face. So even though you are that dark and brooding figure, others cannot help but be attracted to it, which is very typical for those dark fantasy stories. So this very much is a character that you get to have your cake and eat it too. Fantastic damage dealing, great access to magic, and you can be the star of the show if you want to. For this reason, I think that this build does have a little bit of a bad reputation, not only because the notion of multiclassing Paladin and Warlock together can be very controversial from a role-playing perspective.
On top of the roleplay complications, leveling up this character can also be a big challenge. There's a lot to discuss today, so let's get rolling. So roleplay-wise, the Witch Knight takes sort of two ends of the spectrum and combines them together. A lot of people view paladins as the righteous knights fighting for divine entities, where the warlock is a character that often takes their powers from an otherworldly creature and is mostly steered towards sort of that darker and more grim setting. Now, a lot of people say that these two things can't meet, but especially in 5th edition, I think what we've seen is both of these types of characters kind of diverge from their standard type and kind of cross paths a lot more than expected. Paladins have oaths like the Oath of Conquest and the Oath of Vengeance, which very well might be swearing an oath to an entity that isn't a righteous divine being. Or if you want a little bit more of that fey flavor, you have something like the Oath of the Ancients. Either way, when we look at the Hexblade Warlock, you're really sworn to a weapon or a blade of some sort, which speaks very well to a paladin who maybe is swearing their oath to some entity that is a little bit more warlocky in nature.
On the warlock side of things, the Hexblade Patron is the core of this whole idea, because the main focus of this build is noticing that paladins do a lot of cool things with charisma, and warlocks do all their spell casting with charisma. And a Hexblade Warlock can use their charisma to make melee attacks instead of their strength, thanks to the Hex Warrior feature. So the idea here is to build a character that is able to pump their charisma score and use that for their melee attacks, their spell casting, and even adding that to their saving throws and a ton of other things. I also think that there's a great argument to be made for role-playing the Witch Knight as sort of a cursed or tragic figure. I like to imagine particularly stories like Shadow of Mordor, where you saw a warrior who had a near-death experience or a death experience on the battlefield and maybe was slain by a cursed blade and has come back to life thanks to their Hexblade Patron, or been sort of possessed by an evil spirit or artifact in some sort of way. Or maybe, you know, for me, the archetypal example in many sort of ways here, I like to think of Arthas from the Warcraft series, who took up the cursed blade Frostmourne. So in many ways, if you want a character that feels like Arthas from Warcraft 3, you kind of got this. Here's your Death Knight, right? You might not be able to do too much of the raising undead thing, but actually that's even an option on the table still for this character.
For myself, I actually loosely look at Spawn as an inspiration for my character, where you have a person who was sent to hell and then sent back up as sort of a warrior of another entity. Mm-hmm. And he chooses to try to use his powers for good, although he is a bit of a cursed and tragic character himself. I'm a big fan of Spawn, and there are some parallels that I can draw here that I actually really enjoy. Either way, there's actually a lot of these tragic figures in literature, comics, film, television, that you can actually draw some inspiration from to really bring this character to life.
I think this is also, if you're a fan of the Eternal Champion series by Michael Moorcock, this is a great way to realize, one of the many ways that you can realize a character like Elric. So there's so many figures in fantasy that if we take off the straitjacket definition of what it means to be a paladin or what it means to be a warlock, this is an inroad to realizing some actually really classic character tropes.
Now, in a lot of our videos where Monty and I are doing a character build, we build separate characters and compare them. But with the nuance and complications of building this multi-class, what we actually found is that most of our build was relatively the same, and where we differed, we realized that the other person maybe did something that we liked, or vice versa. So we kind of combine this all into one build, and at a few points we might talk about various options that might pop up. But for the most part, you have to be pretty careful with how you structure your multi-class.
This is a build where if you do not carefully decide when you advance as paladin and when you advance as warlock, you can end up feeling very miserable at the table because your party members have things like 4th level spells or 5th level spells and extra attack, and you don't. So it's really, really key to hit the right milestones and breakpoints with your build so that, you know, if you get to play this character in a high-level campaign where you start at level 12, it's super easy. But it's all the stuff that comes before that that is actually really difficult about making this character work. And you don't want to spend over half the campaign with a frustrating character experience.
So let's kick things off right away with some of our primary choices in building this character, such as what our ability scores are going to be, and what races and which class we're starting with. In terms of multiclassing, if we want to combine the warlock and the paladin, we're going to need both a strength and charisma score of 13 at least. So these are going to be two big focuses when we're building our character.
In addition, we also have to decide whether we want to start as a paladin and have all of our weapon and armor proficiencies right from the beginning, or if we want to start as a warlock and get the medium armor proficiency and martial weapon proficiency from being a hexblade. For my part and Kelly's part, we discussed this quite extensively, and I think you pretty much gotta start your first level as a paladin. I think having that heavy armor proficiency and going the heavy armor route is the way to go here.
Yeah, you get your heavy armor, you get your martial weapons, you get a lot of the powerful abilities that are gonna actually make you strong at the things you want to be doing right away at level one. So if you are starting at level one, starting with a paladin means that you get to be that frontline melee fighter right away without having to worry about building up the warlock side of things.
Yeah, and for your character race, I think that this is another case where we really want to have a feat early on, because the way the multiclassing shakes out, we're going to delay when we get to take our ability score increases and feats. So playing either a variant human or the custom lineage so we can take that feat at first level is really going to help us overall.
And for both of us, we actually took Great Weapon Master as our feat. Again, we're building a melee combatant, and both of us, I think, wanted to swing a greatsword to start.
Yeah.
So bringing that greatsword into battle, being the big heavy armored, great sword wielding entity on the battlefield is going to be pretty key.
It's worth noting that at low levels of play, you might not use Great Weapon Master that often, but it's worth taking it now so that we can pump our charisma up as quickly as possible later.
For ability scores, this is where it's a little bit tricky, because we are going to want charisma for the long run to be our most important stat. But right off the gate, charisma isn't going to be our primary ability for damaging. However, I still did point by, and I put 15 into my charisma score.
I think because we have to have a minimum strength 13, we should also go all the way to 15 so we can wear plate armor without a penalty. We both did things a little bit differently because I chose the custom lineage and you chose the human. It all ends up coming out the same in the wash, where we end up starting out with a character with a 15 strength, a 10 dexterity, a 14 constitution, an 8 intelligence, a 10 wisdom, and a 16 charisma. Depending on whether you choose a variant human or the custom lineage, depending on if you want the extra skill or the dark vision or what have you, this works out either way, with either the 2+1s or the 1+2. In my case, I did the custom lineage where I hard bought strength 15, started with the hard buy of charisma 14, and then bumped that up to 16.
For myself, I put +1 into charisma and +1 into strength and ended up with the exact same stats as Monty.
Yeah. We played around with a lot of different configurations. There's a way of going medium armor and having a higher dexterity score, but ultimately I think this is the most streamlined way to start things off. And having a 15 strength at the start means that even though we're not starting out with Hex Warrior, so we're not attacking with our charisma, we still have a decent strength score to make melee attacks with using our greatsword. It's not the best, but it still works for the couple of levels that we're going to have to go through. And if you're starting at third level, it's just fine.
So now when we do move on to third level, we're looking at now having 2 levels of Paladin and 1 level of Warlock. This is where we're going to make that switch and start pumping levels into Warlock. But right away with the 2 levels of Paladin, this gives us our fighting style. It also gives us our spellcasting and, most importantly, Divine Smite.
And with our 1 level of Warlock, we're going to choose Hexblade, we're going to get Hex Warrior, and now we're going to be attacking using our Charisma. We're also going to take as our cantrips here, Booming Blade and, of course, Eldritch Blast. And for a smattering of spells, on the Paladin side, we're going to pick up Bless, and on the Warlock side, it really doesn't matter, but we're going to take Shield through the Hexblade, and these 2 first level spells, Bless and Shield, are going to be our bread and butter. Basically, your modus operandi at this low level of play is casting Bless on yourself to offset the penalty from Great Weapon Master, and hitting as hard as you possibly can, and if you do hit, use your single Warlock spell slot to smite.
It is worth noting at this level that we're still not using the Hex Warrior with the Greatsword. This is going to take a little bit to come online. We're still a potent character by mixing the Bless and the Smite together and having Shield just in case. So we're still doing our job on the battlefield, but don't worry, the build's coming.
Yeah, so overall, you're going to have a -1 to attack rolls with Great Weapon Master here. And this is why you're going to want to be using Bless. Because once again, even though we have that Charisma 16 and we have Hex Warrior, you need to have the Pact of the Blade and be using a Pact weapon to be able to use a Great Sword with Hex Warrior. So we're not going to get that until we're a third level Warlock when we actually get our Pact boon, which we're not going to be till level 5. But we're going to go there. We're going to get to level 5. We're going to take 3 levels of Warlock along the way. We're going to take the Pact of the Blade right away. So now we can use our Greatsword with Hex Warrior. It gives us a +1 bonus to attack rolls from what we had before. Our proficiency bonus goes up. But now we also have 2nd level Warlock spell slots, which means that we have a little bit more flexibility with what spells we use. We can still use these to smite. But we also get to choose some invocations here, which are going to allow for some really interesting things.
With our invocations, we are going to take Eldritch Mind. That's one of my primary choices. This is a new invocation that was added in Tasha's Cauldron of Everything that allows you to have advantage on concentration checks. Now, this is really important because we are both a frontline fighter, but we also are always going to be concentrating on a spell. Yeah. There's a lot of options here. Even at these early levels, we're concentrating on Bless, and we don't want to lose that.
Yeah.
So, Eldritch Mind, but I also think that we want to take Devil's Sight, and we're going to grab the Darkness spell. Now, there is an interesting play here. We all have probably heard of the Devil's Sight Darkness idea. Having Devil's Sight means you can see in your own darkness, means you can cast Darkness on yourself and have advantage on all attacks while enemies have disadvantage against you. You do want to be aware of your party dynamics. Sometimes this works really well, but there are times that this can be detrimental to your party. A great example that I have seen, though, is in a party with a Shadow Sorcerer and the Hexblade Warlock. When the two of them get together and both are able to see in the darkness, they can handle one side of the battlefield, while the other characters who don't have these abilities handle the other side of the battlefield, and it's actually worked really well.
In addition, now that we're level 5, our Booming Blade is going to add an extra D8 to our damage rolls. So while we're going to feel sad because we're level 5 and we don't have extra attack yet, we can still dish out a fair amount of damage because we've got Great Weapon Master, we've got the extra D8 from Booming Blade, and we've got the Darkness to give us advantage on our attack rolls. If you are in a situation where using Darkness is not ideal, I probably would default to Bless still. And again, it's that circumstance where Bless, you get to target yourself and some party members. Just make sure with Bless, though, that if you can, cast it before combat. It also makes sense to do this with Darkness as well, casting it before combat if you can, to save yourself that action setting it up on the first turn.
So pushing forward, we're going to continue to take levels of Warlock, and now we're going to look at our characters at level 7, where we've now taken 5 levels of Warlock. And in my opinion, this is where the entire package comes online in a real powerful way.
I agree. Look at all the things that we're going to have now at level 7. We have Warlock spell slots that are 3rd level. We have the ability to take the Thirsting Blade Invocation, which is going to give us extra attack with our Pact Weapon, which is going to be our Greatsword. We have Great Weapon Master as well at this point too. We're now able to attack twice. We were able to pump our Charisma up to 18 at level 4. So now the accuracy problem is solved. We've got the extra attacks coming in. And now we can really start layering on all the nicely damaging effects with our Warlock spell slots that come back on a short rest. So you can always use your Warlock slots to smite, or you can use your Paladin slots to smite. One of the things that I like here is that Shield is one of those spells that for a single classed Hexblade is a very expensive spell to cast. But because we still have those extra little Paladin slots that are first level, that's probably what we're either going to be using them for Shield or Bless. But then we're going to use our 3rd level slot to bring on a nice damaging buff. And now we could continue using the Darkness and Devil Sight combo, and I think that's always a good default. There's a couple new spells, though, that we can add to the mix that are worth considering here at this level.
A big one to consider is Spirit Shroud. This is, again, a new spell that was added in Tasha's, and it actually makes a really good argument for why you might not need to rely on Devil Sight and Darkness. Still a great thing in your back pocket, but if you're in those situations where casting Darkness is going to be a detriment to your whole party, Spirit Shroud allows you to add an additional D8 to all of your attack's damage. So that actually means that even before smiting, you're still piling on a lot of damage. With Great Weapon Master giving you the -5/+10, and now Spirit Shroud with an additional D8, and if you need to, you can dish out a smite for another 2D8 or higher, depending on the level of spell slot you're using, you can make things dead pretty quick.
Exactly. Just looking at this level, with our proficiency bonus at +3 and our charisma at +7, applying Great Weapon Master, we only have a +2 to hit. But we're either going to be able to bless ourselves or put ourselves in darkness, or if you are in a party where you can get advantage somehow, cast Spirit Shroud and get that extra D8. If you are using Spirit Shroud, you're now going to hit for 2D6 +1D8 plus 14 points of damage. So that is with each attack now, you are looking at an average of about 25 points of damage on a hit. With 2 attacks, 50 points of damage. Again, if you take Spirit Shroud out of this mix and are relying on Darkness, you're losing about 4.5 points of damage on each attack. That's still 40 points of damage as a level 7 character. And the advantage really swings the ability for you to hit quite widely, and then you just dump a smite on top of that. Again, if the darkness thing becomes a problem, this is also one of your earliest opportunities where you could take Eldritch Smite as well. So if you really want to go dig deep and fully commit, it is theoretically possible with this character to use a first level spell slot to smite as a paladin, cast Spirit Shroud on yourself with a 3rd level slot, and then use Eldritch Smite as well. deal, which is going to add a grand total of a lot.
A lot.
A grand total of a lot. You're going to be rolling a lot of D8s and ruin someone's day. And of course, if you do use your Hexblade's Curse to get that 19 to 20 crit range and add your proficiency modifier to the damage on top of that, oh boy.
Yeah, now we're cooking with gas.
You are. But you know what a big thing that you're running into with this problem is? A lot of things want to use your bonus action.
Yeah, and this is actually why you hear us talk a lot about Great Weapon Master and Polearm Master, but we actually aren't taking Polearm Master, because Polearm Master is also trying to take your bonus action for an additional attack. But with so much going on with our bonus action already, it's kind of just nicer to smash something with a greatsword sometimes.
Yeah, it's really difficult too, because we would love to get Misty Step and Thunder Step into our spells known here as well, but we're still quite constrained for spell slots. So ultimately, the strategy with the Hexblade is really going to be get that really good concentration spell going so that you can get the maximal benefit for your spell slot across an entire combat encounter, and use your smite strategically, especially at this level. If you play it like your standard paladin smiting on every attack, you're going to run out of your spell slots. Now, of course, the nice benefit here is you're a warlock, so they come back on a short rest, but plan carefully. Another spell that you might want to consider here at this level is Summon Shadowspawn. These are the new summon spells from Tasha's Cauldron of Everything, and arguably, they do more damage than having the Spirit Shroud on top of you.
The Shadowspawn is a really potent body to put on the battlefield. Not only is it more hit points and something else for your enemies to attack, but compared to just adding a D8 with Spirit Shroud or having advantage with your Darkness, this thing gets to attack your enemies. It has a really cool scream ability, which can frighten your enemies. And we're going to talk more about that a little bit later as this becomes more powerful. And the other great thing about the summoning spells is they level up really, really well with your character. So as your warlock spell slots increase, you're going to just have a more and more powerful option to summon onto the battlefield. Not to mention that as you're leveling up your Hexblade, you're also going to get other little creatures that you can bring onto the battlefield. And soon enough, you have a little menagerie of evil spirits and entities that are following you around into battle. And it's pretty cool.
Now, at this point, we're level 7. And there's a very strong temptation here, actually, to just stay at those two levels of Paladin and go the rest Warlock. But for our build, we're going to switch back to the Paladin and level up a couple more levels.
So jumping ahead to level 11, we've now taken 4 more levels of Paladin. One of the most notable things here is that we actually get to choose our Paladin oath. And actually, we had a big discussion about this. There was a really good option here for the Vengeance Paladin, which is one of our favorites. But we actually think that with this build, the Conquest Paladin is a really great contender. And we actually decided that that's what we would go with.
There's so much synergy with the fear spells that warlocks have access to with some of the with the many other features of the Conquest Paladin. Also, some of the key spells that a Vengeance Paladin gets, like Misty Step and Hunter's Mark, well, we can get Hex and Misty Step from our warlock level, so we don't really need those spells. But what we do get is Spiritual Weapon.
And again, with a lot of things combating for your bonus action, having Spiritual Weapon is probably one of the best options. And remember that Spiritual Weapon doesn't require concentration. We're either going to be summoning a Shadow Spawn or casting Spirit Shroud on ourselves. And on top of that, we are going to have the Great Weapon Master adding additional damage. We can add Hexblade's Curse on top of this. And now on our bonus action, we have our Spiritual Weapon swinging around on the battlefield. So now we have a lot of damage piling up and a lot of different ways to deal damage.
Now, of course, in taking a couple more levels of Paladin, we're going to be able to max out our Charisma. So we're going to get another ability score increase once we reach 4 levels of Paladin. We'll be a 9th level character overall. So we only lose our maxing out our ability score by 1 level, basically. We're only 1 level off. Not too bad. And, of course, once we reach 6 levels of Paladin, we now get the Aura of Protection. So we're adding our Charisma modifier to all of our saving throws and for our allies, which is +5. And we're using that Charisma to make our attacks with our Greatsword. This is where it becomes amazing. The resilience that you have with having your saving throws all getting that +5 Charisma is so good. And we also are getting a couple more paladin spell slots along the way too. As a 6th level paladin, we have 4 first level spell slots and 2 second level slots, in addition to those 2 third level warlock spell slots that come back on a short rest. Getting this little base of low level paladin spell slots is really, really awesome. Because if you compare, if we were a single class paladin, we would actually have roughly the same number of spell slots. A few more, but we wouldn't get them back. We wouldn't get the high level ones back on a short rest like we would as a warlock. So we can use those now for our smites, for our big, really important spells, and we can use the lower level paladin spells for things like if we want to put out darkness, which gets no benefit from being upcast, or if we want to cast hex, or if we want to cast shield. All of these lower level warlock spells that don't really benefit from being upcast are really, really handy to have those extra paladin spells to throw in.
With these level ups, we actually haven't changed our strategy very much. We're going to be putting the same things on the battlefield. We're going to be running in and smashing as hard as we can with our sword. And really, it's just getting more powerful at this point. The spell options that you have, the Great Weapon Master, your two-handed sword that you're running in with, all of these are still in play. And at this point, your charisma being at +5 means that everything is benefiting from your charisma score. Even the Shadow Spawn is gaining a lot from you boosting up all of these abilities. So there's a lot at play here. And again, you're kind of that frontline defender. You're laying down the most damage out of probably any character on the battlefield. And you're also the highest charisma face of the party. Talk about a all-star character.
Now, as we go up to the next couple levels, there's a few technical things that we're going to want to do. You do have a choice here. If you really like the fear mechanic, if you love the scaring people with the Shadow Spawn, perhaps if you took the fear spell, if you love the Channel Divinity, you might want to take one more level of Paladin, which is going to give you the Conquest Paladin's ability to cause anyone that you've frightened to have their speed reduced to 0 as long as they are in your Aura of Conquest, which is only 10 feet. If you like this battlefield control strategy, it's very potent. You may want to consider taking this additional paladin level. We decided not to do that. We're just going to go warlock from here on out. And this is very critical here as well, because the next level of warlock that we want to take, we actually want to retrain the Thirsting Blade invocation. Because as we leveled up as a paladin, we actually naturally got the extra attack class feature. Whereas before, we only got this because we had the Thirsting Blade invocation. We don't need that invocation anymore. So by gaining another level of warlock, we can retrain that out for another invocation of our choice. In my books, if you didn't take Eldritch Smite earlier and were using Darkness and Devil Sight, now's the time to pick it up.
Really, there's a lot of great invocations that you can choose from. And at this point, kind of deciding what your playstyle is. Perhaps you have Eldritch Blast as your ranged attack in case you can't get into melee, where taking something like Agonizing Blast might just help that out. But as we level up even more, there's some great invocations that we're going to want to look at as well. So from here, we're going to push things all the way to level 18, taking Warlock levels all the way. And this is going to give us access to some higher level spells, some more invocations, and just some more power behind our build.
At this point, we're going to be a level 12 Warlock and a level 6 Paladin. We're going to take the level 12 Warlock invocation for Life Drinker, which is going to let us add our charisma modifier again to our damage rolls with our packed weapon, which means that when we swing that greatsword with Great Weapon Master, we can be adding +20 to the damage roll. Of course, if you have a magic weapon, you have anything else to add to this, if you have any other smites or anything else, maybe you lucked out and got a Holy Avenger or a Vorpal Blade or something crazy like that, this thing can just hit like a Mack truck at this point. Now we've also got 5th level spells. Along the way, we can pick up a couple more invocations, but the core invocations that we're going to want at the end are going to be Devil Sight, Eldritch Mind, Life Drinker, and Eldritch Smite. You're going to have 2 other invocations, but it's kind of up to you what you want to take here.
Also keep in mind that at this point, Shadowspawn can now be cast as a 5th level spell, which when you summon it, now means that it gets to make 2 attacks per turn. This Shadowspawn, now with its 2 attacks, is going to be averaging about 25 to 30 damage per turn, on top of your already incredible damage that you're dealing with all of these other options. Now, again, as a Hexblade, you can also, if you kill an enemy, summon that spirit that,
yes,
that can
you
join
can.
You.
Yeah.
So you have your Shadow Spawn, your weapon floating around, your spirit, and yourself all adding to the battlefield in a meaningful way.
And because now we did get an extra spell slot and we have 5th level spell slots, we can upcast Spiritual Weapon if we want to. We can summon that Shadow Spawn. We can, or we might take other spells and use spells like Dimension Door or Thunderstep. Possibly even pick up the Invocation to get Polymorph. Maybe we want to take Banishment, Synaptic Static. Again, use the spells to augment what you want to do. And you might want to look to utility as well. Maybe you want to take Invisibility. Maybe you want to take Fly. Maybe you want to just have those spells that are going to give you some extra capabilities outside of combat, because between Spiritual Weapon and the Shadow Spawn and Great Weapon Master and everything else, like, you got the damage thing figured out.
And when it comes to feats, you first of all obviously want to max out your charisma. That's the most important thing. But you're going to get some other feat options along the way. And really, this is also up to your build. We kind of discussed ideas like taking Inspiring Leader is a great one because of your charisma. You can help bolster the party. I also grabbed Sentinel along the way, which I just thought helped me be that frontline defender, which is protecting the party. So really, it's up to you to choose some really great options, but a lot of feats can help benefit this. You might also consider Resilience for Constitution in case you really want to land those Constitution saving throws.
Yeah, you can't really go wrong just boosting up your Constitution score either, taking Resilient along the way, and kind of just grabbing whatever grab bag feat that you wanted. Because really, this is the big benefit of this build, is that because your charisma, once you have that up to 20, you've got everything that you need. If you didn't even want to take Polar Master, you could. But I do feel that with this specific dynamic, you're kind of at a point here where your bonus action is super saturated. There's so many things that you can do with it that it really becomes difficult to decide what your attack sequence is going to be. And that's ultimately the hardest thing about playing the Hexblade, is that it's really tempting to look at the theoretical of going, oh, if I stack this buff, this buff, this buff, this buff, I can do so much damage. You probably don't need to go that far to blow up the world with this character.
At the end of the day, when we're looking at this build, a few things to keep in mind. Number one, it's going to be an extremely powerful build, but you do want to note that it does take some time to really come into its own. If you're playing a campaign that is only going to be low levels and not going to stretch into the higher levels, this may not be the greatest option for you. Where this multiclass really comes on the line is once you hit level 7 and then moving up to level 12. Between those levels is where you're going to start to really feel the power of this build. At low levels, we've tried to design it so that you won't be too weak. You'll still be able to do your job on the battlefield. You might feel a little bit behind some of the other characters, but don't worry, your time is coming. In a long-term campaign, this is not only a really powerful character to play, but if you, again, strip away the ideas of what you think a paladin or a warlock should be and focus on how you can combine these into something much more interesting and living out a new fantasy that we don't really get to play out as much in a game of D&D, you might find a lot of fun here for both role-playing and the potency on the battlefield.
This is a very complex and technical character build, but it is one that is rife with really cool role-playing opportunities as well. If you're someone like us that enjoys playing powerful characters, but you also love kind of laughing at yourself of being such an edgelord playing a dark character, it's a lot of fun to play. I've had so much fun making quippy one-liners as I played my Witch Knight, and I really do find it's a very satisfying character archetype to play. It's a challenging one, but that's part of what makes it so rewarding.
So this has been a look at how to play a Witch Knight in Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition. If you've tried this multi-class combination yourself, tell us about how it went in the comments below.
The videos that we create on our channel are made possible thanks to the incredible generosity of our Patreon supporters. If you enjoy the work that we do here on YouTube, please consider supporting our show by following the links in the description below.
And don't forget to check out our live play Shadows of Drakenheim, which airs Tuesday nights at 6 p.m. Eastern on Twitch. You can find all the previous episodes right up over here.
And we've got plenty more guides for so many other character builds in D&D 5e right up over here.
Please subscribe to our channel so that you never miss an episode.
Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you next time
in the dungeon.